this evening for an event I like to just call, title it two words, Serpentine Pavilions, in plural, meaning this is an opportunity this evening to have a discussion around not just this year's wonderful pavilions over in the park that many of you would have seen this summer, but also if we remind ourselves that this project that Julia began in the year 2000, by looking back across that full length, means a subtext of tonight's event will be, in fact, it's a history of the 21st century, which is always a nice thing to do while a century is still relatively young. The pavilion project that you all know well started, as I said, in 2000 with the commissioning of Zaha Hadid to do a first of what became very quickly a kind of annual, not just architectural, but public ritual within the city, around the completion of a pavilion that would test ideas and experiment with possibilities related to the work of the architects involved in that. One of its striking features, you could say, is that Julia and the team at the Serpentine always make very sure the architects have very little time to do that work. Part of its genius, you could say, is that people just need to do it. And I'm sure that will be a part of this evening's discussion in some way. And in that way, introduce, as pavilions as a form tend to, the capacity to think on the fly, and in another topic that I think will be a part of this evening's discussion, make decisions collaboratively, and not just between the different members of a design team, but also indeed with Julie and everyone in the gallery and everybody involved in the project itself. One of its premises was that it would be an opportunity to invite architects from around the world to come and build a project in England. And I won't say too much about the brief itself. Julia will talk about that in just a moment. Tonight is really meant to be an opportunity to bring together the architects involved in working with Julia and everyone at the gallery to talk about this year's experience, so let's say the roller coaster realities of what it meant to deliver those wonderful projects that we saw over in the park, talk a bit about that collaborative framework for how things came together in the form they did, and to talk a little bit about the results, how things were received by the public, lessons learned by everybody involved, and how this sort of a project goes forward, not just in a wonderful setting like that over in Hyde Park, but indeed as a way of thinking and working on architecture far beyond the site of the gallery itself. So tonight's guests are architects, as I said, involved with all of this year's Serpentine Pavilion and the four summer houses that were uniquely a part of this year's brief and provided for the event. And I think the first thing I could do is maybe just very briefly introduce everyone before I turn over to Julia herself to say a few things about the project. Julia Peyton-Jones, I think everybody knows in this room already, a frequent visitor and collaborator here at the AA over many years and for many different kinds of public events. She inaugurated the annual Serpentine Gallery Pavilion in 2000, as I said, and in fact has curated and cultivated it throughout its life over 16 extraordinary years and all of the projects that came out of that. In 2013, she oversaw the expansion of the gallery into a second building, the Sackler Gallery, and saw that project through alongside all of the annual ones, and recently has stepped away as director of the gallery and is pursuing her own work as an artist here in London. Maria Solé Bravo is here from, having just arrived from New York, is a senior designer at BIG, Bjarke Ingels Group there, and was project architect of this year's Unzipped Wall, the pavilion that many of you will have seen in front of the Serpentine Gallery. She graduated from ETSAB, which has a Spanish title that I can't pronounce, I'm sorry, in Barcelona in 2005, has worked at the Royal Danish Academy of Fine Arts in Copenhagen, is based in New York, and kindly made a long flight over for tonight's event. Frank Barkow, some of you will have known from some of the events we've done here over the years. Frank is a former unit master here at the A many years ago, where we first met here, and with Regina Leibinger in 1993 founded their office in Berlin, where they continue to practice. Sorry, manager is telling me I need to do this. Sorry, I'll do that. He's been a visiting professor at the Royal College of Art in London, the EPFL, the AA here in London, Cornell, and various other places. And it's a pleasure to invite Frank back. Frank and Regina have exhibited their work here. Some of you will remember an atlas of their prototypes and experiments that we exhibited here a few years ago. Next to Frank, Asif Khan works across the fields of architecture, industrial, and furniture design. Asif is a graduate of the A not so long ago, I'm pleased to say, and it's absolutely fantastic always to welcome our graduates back here. He was included as a shortlisted finalist amongst a group of 1,700 competitors for the Guggenheim Helsinki competition a couple of years ago, designed a landmark pavilion at the 2012 London Olympics, and has recently been chosen and has been a designer in residence of a program at the Design Museum here in London, and was awarded Designer of the Future in 2011 in Design Miami, it was. Asif, it's a pleasure to welcome you back. And Kunlé Adeyemi, who many of you will have seen before here, has a visitor and a critic occasionally at the AA, founded his Amsterdam-based practice, NLE. How do we pronounce that? NLE, in 2010. He studied at the University of Lagos in Nigeria and Princeton University, where we first met many years ago. And went on to work at the Office of Metropolitan Architecture for nearly a decade before starting his own practice in Amsterdam. And Kunlé has come over from there. And I think I haven't left anyone out, but should mention, who is not here today, the other builder of a summer pavilion this year will be represented by a beautiful new book that I think he would be very pleased to have us share with you all here. Yona Friedman was the final architect that this year participated in the Pavilion program, who installed one of his remarkable space chain technique buildings slash performances slash installations of an extraordinary form. Yona Friedman has for many years been one of the great experimenters and prototypers within architecture, and the quote on the back of this book will stand for Yona's place for the rest of this event, where he simply says, "I am not a utopist, but a realist. My realism is not of the same kind as that of most mainstream architects," which I think this book proves to good form, as does his summer pavilion this year in Hyde Park. And I think with that as an introduction to everyone, I'm going to hand it over to Julia to say a few words about the program.
Thank you. Well, it is a very great honor to be here. Thank you very much for the invitation. And also, thank you very much for, in effect, providing a school reunion. Not everybody's here. But there's something about working on these projects that you are forever bonded. I feel I'm with my brothers and sisters. I'd like to mention before we start a few other people in the audience who are notable, notable to realizing the pavilion. In the front row, Julie Burnell, who is head of projects at the Serpentine, who has done an astounding job. She had a very specific training to do the job of being head of projects at the Serpentine. She was a nurse. And something I saw in her interview obviously persuaded me that she could go on to build pavilions, even though in the early days she said absolutely not. She wouldn't have anything to do with art. And I don't think architecture was even a twinkle in our eye then. Rose Dempsey, who has been so amazing in promoting all the work of the Serpentine, of course, including the pavilions. Hanif here, who worked on all the projects, but in particular the big pavilion, the main pavilion at the Serpentine. David Glover, who has been associated with this project for many, many years, who's stuck on a train. I hope he will come. He's the boss of Intelligent Engineering. Cecil Balmond, who is the architect at Arup, who really was our partner from the very early days, and who encouraged me, just by his kind of tacit support, to be ambitious. And Peter Rogers, the brother of Richard, who was also in tandem with Peter, kind of in tandem with Cecil, was part of those very important early years. And then Ed, who's sitting in the nestling in the third row, who's part of the team of Arup, who helped do so much for the pavilions. So I want to talk a little bit about context before we kick off with some of these beautiful things. And we started, maybe interestingly, at the end. This is the Yona Friedman. Luckily, they got the architect's name at the bottom underneath the image. So if you don't know the work, or you don't associate the work with the architect who did it, you've got it spelled out for you. The context is incredibly important. And There's one other name, of course, I should add to those I've already mentioned, which is Hans Ulrich. We worked in tandem for 10 years. We shared, it was one of the reasons we got together, to work collaboratively. We share a love of architecture. And he can't be here, but I know we'd send you all his love. So that represents those who are present and that indeed those who are absent. The Serpentine is a not-for-profit institution with 5 strands to its programs: architecture, design, education, and public programs, which gets 16% of our funding from government through the Arts Council of England and raises approximately £7 million per annum without charging admission. Pre-1996, the Princess of Wales was our patron, and we held gala dinners with Vanity Fair to raise money to renovate the building, the Serpentine, and you will see pictures of this beautiful building at some point in this run. It's going to, I think, come up soon. And it wasn't planned that the Serpentine would have such a commitment to architecture. It was born out of necessity, partly our size, and partly the need to renovate the building because it was leaking like a sieve and we couldn't do the shows that we wanted to do. So it was really essential. I began at the Serpentine in the days when there was an immense antipathy to contemporary art, and architecture wasn't even discussed because it wasn't necessary. It wasn't even necessary to have an antipathy to it. It wasn't on the kind of agenda. The early programs included Jean-Michel Basquiat, Man Ray, Damien Hirst, Agnes Martin, Robert Gober. It had a terrible leaky roof, but it had an incredible chairman. Peter Palumbo, who's just stepped down as chair of the Pritzker Prize, a collector of architecture in the form of buildings by Mies van der Rohe, Corbusier, Frank Lloyd Wright, amongst others, who gave the Serpentine the freedom, the privilege to explore our architectural commitments. The renovation was by John Miller and Partners, who renovated the Whitechapel. And what they did was they turned a pint into a quart pot by somehow squeezing in into everything that we needed to put into the building and to make it a museum when we wanted to use it as a museum and to make a context for the sign of its expression and inspiration and when we wanted to approach culture from a different point of view. After the renovation in 1998, Mike Bloomberg, who's now the current chairman, became a trustee. It was before he became mayor of New York. And we opened the galleries with Manzoni, which was an extraordinary exhibition. Piero Manzoni is an artist of immense distinction, and certainly not something that we could do pre-renovation. And the point was to show people actually how far the gallery had come. And in the early days post-renovation, we did William Kentridge, now, of course, showing at the Whitechapel, but that is 16 years ago or more. The very important fabric pieces by Louise Bourgeois was an early exhibition, Terman Prize nominees, and Andreas Gursky, who at the time was actually at the very height of his power. In 2000, it was our 30th anniversary, but prior to that, when we were closed for the renovation, we invited Zaha to reconstruct a small bookshop that we had in Warren Street, which never really proceeded because we had didn't have the money and she didn't, perhaps, it just didn't happen. But by that time, she'd been a trustee for probably 3 or 4 years. And so she was somehow kind of really integral to the Serpentine. And it was Chris Smith, who at our 30th anniversary, who allowed Zaha's structure to stay on the lawn. And being in a royal park is a very special privilege, but it's also something of a curse, because you cannot do what you want to do. And so that intervention changed everything, absolutely. And the big question for us was, having done it once, would we do it again? And there was something incredibly exciting. Everything was predicated on this idea of exhibiting architecture in the years that followed. But the first time was a kind of, was to explore what would happen if we used the same budget that we'd had to install a marquee for the galas in the 90s, and we gave it to Zaha to design a structure. And it worked. It was incredibly exciting, incredibly interesting. One of the, and then, of course, from 2000, the these are the structures that followed. Maybe we could just go to that first picture by Zaha, if that's possible, just so that you can see. It was never meant to stay up. But what it did, Chris Smith said that we could have it. No, that's 2013. So we go right to the beginning. So it's that one third to the left, top row. That's it. And there might even be a picture of the furniture she designed for the inside. I hope there is. If there isn't, well, there isn't. Yes, here. So it was about when we were 30, talking, conveying what the architect, what the Serpentine was then, and still is now. So all the sort of tortured flowers of the that Vanity Fair had installed, all the decoration was stripped back to the absolute minimum. And it was a very, very different kind of message that we were giving, and a very, very important one. There are certain aspects of the Serpentine Pavilion that are particular to us. We have no budget. We also have no skill. We're not specialists from the architecture world. It is an exhibition of models, photographs, and drawings, as Brett has talked about, 6 months from conception to completion. Everything's predicated on the exhibition model, so we work with architects in exactly the same way as we commission artists. There are no contracts, there are no letters of agreement, everything is done on a handshake, and we raise the funding from scratch. And in any 1 year, it's not true of the early days, but it can range from $750,000 to a little bit more than that. All the pavilions are sold, partly because it's part of our financial plan to recoup some of the costs of doing them, but also as a legacy of the project. So you will find pavilions in Europe particularly, and also in this country. I think that what is fascinating about this project is this idea, and it was part of Hans Ulrich's and my mantra, was to think the unthinkable, is that sometimes no knowledge is a very good thing. And I think it was particularly true in our case. Whilst respecting hugely, of course, the architecture profession and the knowledge that exists, which I don't have. I wasn't trained as an architect. My training was as a visual artist. It meant that we could do things that other people would know better not to try. The reason this year we included the exhibition of architecture, which is what these pavilions are, was to see what would happen if we invited and expanded the idea of an exhibition of architecture in the form of inviting architects, three of which are sitting here, to respond to Queen Caroline's Summer House, which is a beautiful little temple, a stone's throw from the gallery. The budget was smaller, the footprint smaller too, but this is resolutely a project about architecture, not about art. I refute this idea that these are art projects or sculpture. They're not. They're about architecture. The commission is by architects, and only once have we included an artist in that lineup, which was, of course, Olafur Eliasson with Kjetil Thorsen. This kind of experimentation, particularly after 15 years of doing a pavilion, which was a sort of one structure, on the lawn, a kind of town square, a place where people met, place where they created. I felt entirely comfortable being in that space and also entirely comfortable using it as their own, was, I think, continues to be a very, very important part of the way in which it's used. And also one other thing is the degree of comfort people felt about inhabiting a space of contemporary architecture whilst often voicing a very significant resistance to the idea of contemporary architecture. So this gives you a run of the pavilions that we've commissioned and been built. Some of you will be very familiar with a number of them, and perhaps others not, particularly in the early days. I can say that it is an unbelievably exciting thing to work on. And at this point, after 16 years, there's only one other project that is now developed its own momentum, which is in Melbourne, the M Pavilion, conceived by Naomi Milgram, who takes as its starting point the Serpentine project. Mm-hmm. So it's, I feel very grateful, particularly grateful to the architects here, but indeed all the architects that we've worked with, and obviously the Serpentine team.
Terrific. Thank you, Julia. Thank you for the introduction. I think I'm going to open it up now to our guests to provide some initial conversation around a couple of points. I think surely one of the features that's striking, if we think of these as architectural projects, is that it's just being done at the speed it is. And I'm wondering if anybody could say something about what that experience was like. Julia, by last January, let's say, had a good 16 years of experience with that life cycle of projects happening almost instantly, but just at the level of your own offices and the ideas that were emerging, what came out of just having to deliver it with that kind of speed, other than probably sheer terror at the beginning?
Should I leave the room now?
here.
Well, I think it was a mad dash. I mean, I think we had the commission sometime after Christmas, and there was this sort of mad urgency of putting a project together. But I think, so we began, you know, I think like everybody, started producing ideas as quick as possible. I mean, then there was this issue of having a curator. So we were constantly in a dialogue, which was different. I mean, we all do things like biennales, and we produce a project for it. But we never had this kind of interface with the curator, the idea of a constant dialogue. I think one of the things that made it maybe so desperate to find a project, and I remember you saying it's all there, you know, visiting our studio, coming to Berlin, was this idea, what is architecture, what is art? So I think as we were negotiating the idea of a project, that was an interesting conversation. What qualifies an architectural project versus, say, artistic production, particularly for us in a place like Berlin, where architects and artists are sliding back and forth over each other's territories quite a bit. So I thought that was an interesting conversation. I think when we were doing something that was maybe too artistic, there was this funny silence for about 48 hours. And then Julia would come back and say, I don't think so. And there would be this kind of then, you know, thinking the project, but I think that time, the urgency forces you to produce something, and I think there's some, you know, because you've done this so long, but for us, I think there's this kind of strange, desperate urgency that makes you produce something you would otherwise not do, and I think that was fascinating, that process.
The last time Bjarke was here, I think he, in one of the projects towards the end of the lecture, he showed something like 1,500 different schemes done for one of those buildings, and did it as a kind of sort of lightning race through all of that. What was it like for you as a kind of working rhythm within the studio? And maybe also from doing it slightly from further afield in New York, I presume, which is where a lot of the work was.
Well, I mean, regarding just like the pavilion, I mean, it was, it is, of course, the time is kind of one of the things that drives this, the project. But actually, I don't think it's like in a negative way, but it's a bit like Frank is saying, that it really pushes you to like produce and be very wise about what type of building are you proposing. And I mean, the schedule was totally crazy. Like, we got the call like 2 weeks before Christmas, and then it's like, well, and Julia is coming in 10 days for a workshop that we host at 7 a.m, like totally. And of course we came up with like, you know, 20 different models. We wanted to produce a lot of things, and then it was really interesting with Julia's you know, experience of all those years and knowing very clear what this pavilion should be, and also like telling us what's her experience on past pavilions and, you know, what works, what not. So I think as a curator, it was really, I mean, I think you kind of saw, we in January, I think it was 2nd of January, we had already 3 proposals, and Julia really knew which one was going to be the final that we were going to choose. And so it was very, it's very good to have Julia as a curator for driving your ideas. Not really, because, you know, we could just kind of gone through all kind of different directions, but I think there was something very interesting about, you know, the spatial experience. And I mean, of the schemes that we had and the one that we finally developed, it was very much conditioned by how Julia thought, explained us that we should perceive the space inside.
I must say, at this point, I feel like I'm the biggest pain in the ass ever. And of course, it's 100% true. And you're being very polite, because Kasu Fujimoto tells a story about, you know, and he makes it a joke. And it's only because he was Japanese and very polite that at the time he didn't take out a kitchen knife. The reason I'm interjecting is because I do feel a bit squeamish about the process and massive intervention. But it's also a kind of uncontrollable itch, is the only way I can put it.
Well, I mean, if I may just chip into that, I think it's a fantastic experience, actually. And, you know, I've never had a client that actually says, well, you know, you have all the time to design, in fairness. You know, it's always time pressure on design. But I think what makes the Serpentine project and Julia's process a little intense is that you know it's going to happen. It's like 6 months and... You know, so it's both pressure, but also an incredible rewarding end that you can see that this is actually, you know, it's not going to be one of these extended, prolonged, painful experiences. So if you get it right, you're actually going to make it happen. And so it was...
At least the pain is going to be contained.
Yeah, it's going to be contained, exactly. So it was worth trading in the Christmas holiday for for that sort of pain.
It's a crazy Christmas present that you get. You can only enjoy 6 months later, but...
Asif, if you've done pavilions also leading into this. I'm just wondering to talk about this experience compared to some of your other...
I mean, it was the fastest ever experience. We're used to working fast. But often you're working in isolation in those cases, and you're kind of pitching... you're shooting in the dark in a way, hoping that the thing that you put forward will be received well. I think when Julia called us, at first I thought it was a competition. So I was like, oh, we'd love to be part of this competition. No, it's not a competition. You have to do it. You are doing it. And it's like, you know, okay, I've never been in that situation before. It's amazing.
Wallet,
yeah, it's not, it's, I mean, it doesn't drop on your lap like that. And then actually the feeling of, then I think Julia was, I think at our studio, you know, 24 hours later, for the first sort of project meeting in a way, and this is amazing because it was actually she started to I'm going to say this, I think it's a really interesting thing that I think because of your background and kind of curatorial and fine art background, you see work differently from how architects see their own work, and Julia started picking up models from the studio and collected them together onto the table. So a table about this big. And in the end, it had 30 or 40 small things on there. And she said, the project's here. Which is, you know, actually there's a kind of vision which I hadn't had. I mean, I couldn't, she said, you already know what you're gonna do. You're ready to do it. What this is a freeze frame of now for you. And somehow this released me to think about the work differently, like just sort of enjoy it and let it come out because it's there, rather than this fear. You often feel so it's so painful actually, and normally the other thing was I was thinking when she came to the studio, is that she had been with, you know, Niemeyer, she'd been with you know, Sana, she'd been with Peter Zumthor, and then now she's with me, and I felt like so oh God, how do I compare to this? To all these great lovers you've had, and you do because
you pressure.
No, yeah, you know. So, but you're so sort of sympathetic actually to understand people's differences, and this was really great to understand that you were looking for the differences, which was then it makes you feel that you're welcome. Yeah.
And was this all just a way to kick things off at the holidays and get things going and say we'll see you in June, or was this the basis for a kind of dialogue that then plays out over weeks and months at a time?
Yeah. I was actually just going through today for fun our first. Usually we do these updates like when we like advanced design, and we had like an update PDF every day. Like, it was crazy. So we had calls over Christmas, like conference calls, like almost every week or twice a week. And yeah, so then I was in New York, and then Biago was traveling, and you know, I had to gather like whoever was in New York over Christmas. I had to ask, please, like, come help me, because of course it's like very hard. It's a very difficult time to like gather a team. So, but I mean, that's the thing that everyone, I mean, people were really offering to, like, everyone that was in New York was offering to work on the project of the pavilion, because everyone is aware of, like, that you're somehow making, like, you know, this little bit of architecture history in a way. So, so I mean, that's the magic of this project.
I mean, one of the repercussions must be also, though, that sense of time is playing a different role in the project, is spreading out amongst the collaborative team itself. It isn't just between yourselves and Julie and as a client, but also you're having to mobilize everybody in the team to think this way, I presume. And were there any lessons or discoveries in that, maybe, that were?
Well, I mean, David's not here, but Julie's here. But I mean, once we sort of found a scheme, I think they would come in at doing the role of both protecting the idea and sort of putting limits on things. So I think that conversation was pretty interesting, the kind of doability, buildability of such a project in such a short time frame. So I think that conversation, I mean, all the sort of goodwill of David, you know, over the years here, you know, at the AAA somehow disappeared and became very tough.
Yeah.
Guy, you know, is like, no, you need to limit this thing, you need to forget that. So, I mean, there was this kind of, with the timeline also, and at the same time, there was this kind of back and forth between other participants in the project to sharpen that focus of the thing in a kind of just pulling the thing off in this crazy time frame.
Yeah, I mean, I think the team was amazing. We couldn't have done it without. And it's all well set up, right? So it's like a plot. Julia and Hans start this thing, and they give you this call, and then, you know, you're panicking, and a few days you have to start thinking on your feet, and then, and they have incredible incisive ways of just making the right choices about these things. They see it, you know. I think 16 years of working on these kinds of things, you know, she's claims she's not an architect, but I think her judgment is sharper than most architects in terms of what is right. And we were very happy about her choice, actually. She saw it and was like, that's it, you know. And then, you know, we collaborated with ACOM. We worked with Stage One to produce our work with grants. And then there's a phase, so we have these interactions where we refine the design, and then Julia and Hans pass this thing over to Julie. Then the fun really starts. Because she keeps it on track, she keeps it happening, you know, the construction timing, and yeah, she's done it so many times. It's amazing to see, you know, to feel that this is gonna happen because there's someone right there to make sure everything fits together. So it's, I mean, it's tough, but there's a comfortable team around you to ensure that you don't really suffer.
Before we go into some of the interesting questions around that, did each of the projects at some point tip? I was really struck by that point you made earlier, Julia, about these wanting to be, about you wanting these to be architectural projects. So I'm wondering, did any of you hit the moment where there was suddenly too much art on the table? And was it pulled back from that moment?
Yeah.
Like the art alarm went off?
Right, like, well, right before the 48 hours of silence. Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think there was this kind of negotiation. Because, I mean, you're also doing this project, I mean, for yourself, right? And you want to situate this somehow within the context of a practice. So it's experimental. It's a prototype. It's something that you want to have a kind of currency beyond doing, you know, a four-month pavilion. So I think you're pushing as far as you can. So particularly between these boundaries of what is supposed to be art or what's supposed to be architecture and what qualifies that. So, and I do. I mean, I think I do believe in architecture still as a discipline, but that became a pretty interesting question about what qualifies that. Is it form? Is it space making? Is it certain kind of occupation of the site and context you spoke about earlier? So That was super interesting. And so it did come fairly late in a very compact process, but the the project comes fairly late.
I was struck with the descriptions you all published with the projects this summer, that context was important in different ways for these projects. You write about the experience of the park. I see if you were quite overt in that description of how it was trying to provide a kind of viewing machine for seeing the park itself in a different way.
I think we all, the process was sort of combining this, this sort of snapshot of where you were and what you were thinking at that moment with this incredibly rich context. So for those who don't know, the Kensington Gardens has a really rich history of sort of picturesque landscaping. And a lot of it itself is a kind of architectural or landscape architecture experiment. And so it's had a history of like follies for hundreds of years. And structures in the park for viewing, for sitting. It's got, Henry Moore sculpture sits opposite on the other side of Serpentine Lake, which itself is also a kind of piece of landscape experimentation. So it was quite interesting because you, as an architect, you very rarely are in a group show. It's just something an artist is quite used to, but an architect is never seeing their work in relation to other architects unless it's stuff in the city that's there that you find. So we were sort of, there was a kind of dynamic relationship where everyone was waiting to kind of see what the other ones had proposed and then to kind of adjust slightly, you kind of slightly rotate your structures, to find the right the right kind of balance. But also with William Kent, who's 1734, who was a kind of fifth architect co-opted into the group show, right? So we were also relating to him and this Queen Caroline's temple.
The architect of the original
sculpture, the original temple.
A temple that had been sort of languishing, unloved and unlooked at. And in thinking about how we could expand the project and make it relate to the Serpentine and be complementary to the pavilion, this seemed to be something that was worth exploring. I mean, maybe never to repeat, or maybe to repeat. That's for future years and, it's not within my gift. But this idea of how to continue to exhibit architecture is, I think, a very interesting one. And the Serpentine is a particular place because everything about the Serpentine is so small. I mean, the scale thing is really an issue for us. And in thinking, I think I gave all the architects the same kind of call to arms that I always give every year, which is, the Barcelona Pavilion is really tiny, and it's one of the great masterpieces of all time. And there's nothing that says that something which is small can't be brilliant. And I really firmly believe that. I also firmly believe that, the fact you have no budget is not a limiting factor. There are all sorts of things that are not limiting factors unless you choose to make them limiting factors. And so this idea of turning time on its head and creating a kind of, it's really a sort of compressed way to deliver. It's like, this is the deadline, this is, and we all have to do it. And I'm obviously not working as hard as the architects by any means, but I've happily given up my Christmas and holidays for a number of years because I think it's incredibly exciting.
I mean, one of the interesting features certainly that emerged over the years is, of course, it becomes a public event in its own right. And in a way that, I suppose, by the time you all come into it, early 2016, are also thinking about it also as a kind of event space and not simply as a sort of structure. And I'm wondering if that played at all into your thinking about what the ideas in the project would be. The gathering of crowds, the different kind of events that are held within the pavilion itself, of course, while it's up.
One of the things that I think is very special about the pavilion commission is that is the assignment itself. Like, usually when you think about, it's an ephemeral pavilion, so when you think about ephemeral architecture, somehow usually you think about something very functional, there's a need for these, and then you just make that one architecture piece to host whatever it's needed. Mm-hmm. And then if you want to do something that is more like just a piece to observe and, maybe activate a public space, then you are actually doing public art, so you would maybe commission an artist. But the case of the pavilion is that you actually, the main purpose of the pavilion is for visitors to come and experience and experiment architecture, which is actually something that I don't think I'm going to get a commission like that. You know, it's like, it's very unique. It's kind of very basic, but that's the fact. The main purpose of the pavilion is to visitors to kind of celebrate architecture. So I think that's kind of one of the most exciting things about
It's about feeling architecture. It's about allowing people to feel sensory, what it's like to be in the space. No amount of photographs or drawings can convey that. It's not possible. You just can't. And I mean, looking at these, I go into sort of reveries about what it was like to build them, what it was like to work with the architects, and so on and so on. But the fact of the matter is, two-dimensional images just don't work. They look very beautiful, you know, a great deal of time and care is spent taking beautiful photographs, but that's it. You know, it can't work like that. And I think one of the things that is really developed in terms of the pavilion over the years is, and it's very, very true of this year, is the number of different experiences within that tiny footprint that create something which is very much more than a kind of one-hit kind of experience of being inside the space. And it was really remarkable what Big did, I think.
I think this idea of occupying architecture, though, I think for us was the least predictable aspect of the thing. I mean, I remember Olafur Eliasson saying when he did the Tate Turbine Hall weather project, and they had no idea you would have thousands of kids laying on their backs in this space, you know, spelling fuck bush in the middle of this thing. And I think I think it wasn't until Ivan Bond started photographing these things that, and from the sky and around, that it became evident, I mean, the sort of nuances of how you produce something and how it's appropriated or how it exists in the world. And that was probably the most exciting part of it. I mean, in a very sort of casual but humane way, how something is taken on.
You know, one of the architectural responses one can well imagine when the phone call happens and we've suddenly got a party and a building to be at 6 months from now is to look around the studio and say, are there things happening in the studio that this is an opportunity to test or further? And certainly you could say that's the Mies Barcelona Pavilion model. It's the kind of ultimate prototype of Miesian prototypes that he was building one-to-one throughout Europe for 10 years before he gets the chance for the world to visit that in Barcelona. The other extreme, of course, would be the model like the Philips Pavilion that Le Corbusier builds in Brussels, and I think it's 1960, where they say, well, actually, this is just a chance to do something completely different. And Xenakis and the team that come together make a project that's just so unlike any other core building on the planet that you realize that for them it was a sort of release to just try something completely differently. And at the level of your own studios, how did you treat it? How did you see this? Was there something already being developed within the studio that a bunch of ideas came together around? Or did you see it as a chance to roll the dice and try something out of left field and let's see what happens? It worked in either way. I'm just curious how you all saw it from within.
Well, for us, I think it was a bit of both. It was a chance to, of course, do something completely different because this was a new, totally different context also. Never worked in the UK.
I was going to say, was there anything about the English side of this also that had to be factored in?
Absolutely. the humor. And, you know, I think it's absolutely... It was for us both an opportunity to test something completely different, but also to remain within our core values and continue to reinforce an ideology we're building on, you know. And one of those for us was, how do you learn from an environment? How do you learn from a context to produce? You learn from a past to produce something completely different that is contemporary and new. While retaining, let's say, fragments of the the present, you know.
So specifically, Kunlé, one or two ideas that were in the beautiful piece that you did in the summer. Were there versions of that kind of cooking already in the studio?
No, not at all. It's not necessarily in form. It was really more about the ideology, like you mentioned, and luckily we got a very clear brief to respond to Queen Caroline's temple. And that was just respond to it.
That was the takeoff point.
Point. So for us, it was really about examining Queen Caroline's temple, understanding what it was, you know, the materiality, the space. And we got really fascinated by the space on the inside and the robust form of the material. And while just exploring that, we thought, well, why don't we read it in a totally different way, and you know, by flipping it around and turning it on its side, it exposed the interior space to create a new kind of spatial condition which was more contemporary. So it was just a very simple, almost sarcastic response to an existing situation to produce something new. So that was pretty much it for us. Yeah.
Anybody else on that front? Any out of left field, or we're already working on ideas and they're going to come to the pavilion now?
Well, for us, initially, the first idea Berge had was to totally experiment with new techniques, digital fabrication, and all crazy things. And then Julia was the one who was like, maybe we just want something that is more like your essence of your work. And so we kind of like starts from scratch, and then went back to kind of more to explore like basic elements. So we started working with like the wall, like stairs, ramps, then exploring more like geometries. And so we tried all kind of different things, more conceptual and, I mean, yeah, which would actually relate to what we were doing.
So there's also a very practical issue, which is that the pavilion has to be built. It has a budget, and because we're not for profit and we raise all the money to do it, it has to be built for that money. And I remember Bjarke saying to me, but Julia, it's only £5,000 over budget. And I went, yes, I know, but you know, it can't be done. And that kind of, when an architect is working on projects which are, you know, tens of millions of pounds, this is like, what are you talking about? But that's the nature of the business. And I mean, if we don't sell the pavilion, the Serpentine is in very, very serious financial trouble. I mean, I don't, you know, it's like chop-chop trouble. So it's such a funny business, because the language that we have to do this is something that I can see from the outside is like, what? You know, in every single respect. But then, you know, I always felt when we were doing it that there was something really good that was going to come out of it, that the architects, no matter how much pain they went through, their work would be seen by hundreds of thousands of people that wouldn't have known it, that they would get jobs as a result, that there would be a kind of reception in the world which was more knowing and understanding than existed previously. So those kind of benefits, and partly I would say that, wouldn't I? But those kind of benefits are something which are very particular to this project because of the public's citing of it.
Without giving away figures, though, to know going into it, is there a sense of what the budget will be for the projects, or is that evolving alongside the design?
No.
Just asking. I don't know. That's part of the constraints, like the time, that just drive this thing forward.
Yep.
Yeah, can we good. Say how much it was?
No, we can't. Okay. No, I'm getting the evil eye from the front row.
I'm less interested in the specific sum than in whether it's a kind of understood constraint from the beginning that drives it forward. I think that's the big point, yeah. Although I'm sure everybody's curious. It's a separate.
So you do actually design in a way to optimize for construction. You're trying to think of...
I remember you saying this before. How it's, summer,
exactly, how it's going to be made. How could you make it... simpler? How could you kind of not have a crane on site? How could you, you might try and make lots of elements similar in a way, so that there's repetitious fabrication work, or you know, some of us might do that, others. or the material is one material, which I think all of us did actually. So Yona's is modular in a way, you know, uses kind of off the shelf in a way things. All of us use quite everyday materials because of the kind of the difficulties of the budget, but also it was quite it's quite actually a pleasure to use things that are quite basic that people understand. And this I mean, the public interaction thing is something I wanted to pick up on a little. Is it this, the audience, maybe for all of us, the audience isn't other architects, actually. You imagine it will be. When you first will get the brief, that's something you're concerned about is, oh, you're comparing yourself with other architects, and you're thinking about how other architects see the work. But the ultimate audience is like the 500,000 members of the public who use Kensington Gardens, walk their dogs there, basically. So it's a lot of dog walkers and just normal people who are happening about. And so this thing of not going too artistic or not sort of making things difficult, actually, from an architectural perspective is really important. Like you're trying to make the work inviting in a very simple way, like let people in, let people use structures as they would do like a bench in the park or something. It shouldn't somehow confound them. It should be generous.
I mean, is this two-tier system so that, I mean, a number of pavilions, and I'm sure some houses, are mentioned in, you know, books of architecture, sort of summaries of new architecture now. So that's very much an architectural, that's a curatorial architecture decision, not my own, but I'm thrilled, like the proud parent, when I see them include pavilions, and I hope some houses included. But it's also, as you say, so it has to work on a two-tier level. But that's just the same as making an exhibition. It's the same two-tier level, the specialists and the public.
The other kind of audience, of course, we could ask questions around would be the artists. And given the venue and the context and the kind of individuals that Julie and everyone at the gallery have worked with over the years, did you find artists in the crowd, by the way? And did they clock it as being art or architecture or... related to that, did any of you work with artists as part of the project?
No, I mean, for us it was, you know, because it's an installation, it's always very difficult to keep it outside the realm of art, you know. And I think Julia was incredibly insistent that we have to, it has to be architecture. So we almost had to think about what architecture meant. Like, okay, what really is architecture in this context for a temporary building that, you know, its purpose is really, you know, what it's a summer house. So this was also part of our own analysis. And one of the things that we tried to ensure was that it should serve some of the fundamental purposes of architecture, which is that it could be inhabited in one way or another. We also try to create some of the basic elements of architecture, like a doorway, a room, a window. So literally, but it still looks like a sculpture, right? But I mean, I'm sure she doesn't quite like that, but it's architecture. I mean, I think it's something that treads that line inevitably, but fundamentally, it is architecture.
I think, and with the discussion of the audience, I'd like to, knowing also there are people here that undoubtedly saw it, if I can open it up to questions in the audience, I think it's probably about the right time. Should we do that? Let's see if we can get some questions, everybody.
Yeah, hi. Thank you very much. I had a question that is a sort of challenge a little bit maybe for Julia and taking up on the discussion of the audience and the experience of these pavilions, and that is kind of uncomparable, a photograph and being actually inside. And I think one thing that's especially interesting with the Serpentine Pavilion as a project is that it's it was born before the birth of social media in the way that we understand it today. And I think that one can see a sort of transition from the earlier pavilions to the later ones, that they get more photogenic, actually. And I'm wondering if there's something behind it, because certainly the last three or four have been seen by hundreds of millions, but in photographs, from their friends, not, and Ivan Ban, of course, rather professional photographers, but from people they know and from the viewpoints of the people that they know and care about. And certainly it must have an effect. I was just curious to hear if, in the process of making, if it's ever discussed.
No, never. Because the brief is the same every year. It's about three pages. It's tweaked minorly, really minorly. So each architect has the same amount of money if they're designing the pavilion. They have the same amount of time. They have the same brief. They have the same piece of lawn. And it's really the architect's design that they choose. We might guide it and say, actually, this won't work so well. Or Bjarke's experimentation with materials that Maria talked about. You know, we absolutely took that very seriously, but actually it was going to be hugely expensive and would fall well outside the budget. So the very practical reasons shape a lot of it, and then the experience of me and the team, Hans Ulrich, obviously, our experience comes into it. But that... the evolution of the design is absolutely the architect's decision and nothing to do with us. And there is no conversation about, I mean, the only conversation about audience is statements of fact, like X number of people will come to see it. You know, there will probably be 80 press at the opening and all of that, and it's covered worldwide. But it's not guided in that way. The guidance or the intervention or the curatorial contribution comes in solely in terms of the design work, I believe. But maybe you would say something else.
I think one thing that's changing is that people use social media to sort of document their lives in a way that probably they didn't do before. So the tools are so much more accessible to everyone. I mean, probably in this room, 15 years ago, maybe only two or three people would carry a camera with them. And now everyone has a camera in this room. And the camera is just so much more immediate than writing words about something. So we'll tend to make a note through photographing. I think think because of that, people have got really good at taking photos. So it's maybe that they're not more photogenic. It's that people have got a really good visual sense, particularly square format, Instagram. That's become like this thing, which of course 6x6 is the beginning of that. But at the same time, I don't know if you guys sort of felt this from the other way around. Like on my Instagram, I used it to keep an eye on how people were using the buildings. I found that really fascinating. Mm-hmm. So a lot of them were picked, I mean, I don't know if you had this in yours, but a lot of them were pictures of dogs sitting on metal table structure we made, or children with their heads through the structure, or I had one of the child like standing on top of it. It was like, I don't know how he got up there. But this was really fascinating. So it's a two-way thing. And also it allows you to, I ended up commenting back on people's photos because it's a way of like connecting with like an audience that you wouldn't have ever known before. So there's something quite interesting about that. And then it teaches you a little bit about what works in that experiment, the prototype architecture, what part of the prototype is successful.
I think it's interesting. I mean, the relationship between actually experiencing the thing and understanding it as an image. And if you're talking about the Barcelona Pavilion or the Domino House, as students, you only understood these things as images. So. And the idea of a prototype is, I think, that the thing has a kind of currency, that it has another life. It can be rescaled, it can be rethought, but somehow you generate this thing that it will have some kind of bearing on your practice in the future. So, I mean, the scale of it as an image, I mean, the proliferation of the thing as an image is pretty interesting. And if it can have that kind of resonance, like one of these things as a prototype, then that's kind of interesting because it allows you to think this thing and situate it looking forward it's in a site, it has a context, it relates to a history, but that beyond the experience of it as a thing in the world is quite interesting and is a fairly unique opportunity in this kind of situation.
Thanks a lot again. I have a question again regarding the overall role of the pavilion, whether we look at Biennale, of course, considering all the, like, you know, the formal differences. Up until recent years, Biennale have been a display of pavilion where pavilion, when it gets placed in space, gets activated in some way and becomes part of research speculation, which is not a display of work, but rather work through presenting itself, starts to, you know, raise new questions, asking like for new possibilities, and almost being like as another stage in the research, moving something forward. So pavilion there, again, up until recently, never was like, you know, a statement in itself, but rather more of a question, like, you know, what if we do this, or what if we question this? And I wanted to ask about Serpentine, maybe through the, like, you know, how the brief is given to the architect. Is Serpentine Pavilion, again, is supposed to be, again, some sort of a research, like, you know, in creating the structures which interact with such a wide public? Or is it rather like, you know, a certain show of already pre-established concepts of the office, you know, just bringing it to public? What sort of, like, how did you find Pavilion? What's its role, you know, in this sense?
I mean, I'm going to answer that. And in this context, its directness is perhaps maybe unusual. It really is about exhibiting architecture. So if you take the exhibition model, which is my background, when you ask an artist to show their work, you can do it as a commission, or you can do it from pieces that already exist, or it can be a combination of the two. And if it's a commission, the job of the curator is to work with the artist to realize something that is possible, that relates to their work overall, is specific to the context, and then all the other practical considerations. In this particular sense, the principle's no different, because that curatorial model is a very true and tried one over centuries. And what it does at its best is to allow people to engage with the object in a very particular way. So the skill of the curator is to refine the process to such a degree that the best possible presentation of the artist's work is made. That simple starting point is exactly what we endeavor to do working with the architects. So it is true to say, Hans Ulrich and I might say, what about this way? But we would also do that with the artists we work with. So in that sense, it really isn't any different. With one exception, that architects are used to having clients. And of course, that kind of intervention, greater or lesser, is more of a convention. It's a known fact. Whereas artists, if I think of the opening exhibition of Adrian Villarroja, who opened the Sackler, which was I hope some of you saw it, which was, it took over the whole space. That was as challenging to us as it was to do the pavilion. And it considered all the comparable things that we would consider in working with architects. So it's quite a simple starting point. And in a way, in this very august company, I wish I could be grander about it, but it's your work. Our work is to realize your work. In exactly the same way, our work at the Serpentine is to realize the work of the artists we show. We are not artists. Our job is to make the people, the artists and the architects and designers that we work with, look incredibly good. That's our job. If they look good, we look good, so everybody's happy. And that process of looking good, in inverted commas, in all its ramifications, is a very, very interesting one. And that's why I think the skill of the curator now is widely recognized. Everybody talks about curators, you know, everything is curated, which is another kind of set of, that's another discussion. But it's why it's such a developed skill as a principle. Now, I don't know whether that answers your question, but it's not a foregone conclusion. And there is no question that when I invite any of the architects we've worked with over 16 years, whether for a summer house or a pavilion, that Hans Ulrich or I, or Julie, or any other members of the team, come and say, okay, please do it like that, and thank you very much. We'll see you in 6 weeks.
Julie, there's a question online that somebody has asked. Apparently, people are doing that also this evening.
Great.
As they watch this online, which I'm doing here, with a slight time delay, which is odd to listen. But interesting question. Somebody asked, what's the main difference of curating the project of new architects from the already existing architects you've worked with, the already recognized architects that you've worked with over the years, which I guess is a question presumes there is a difference, or that we can draw a line between recognized architects and emerging voices, like some of this summer's architects. But is there a difference, and does it come down to just the difference in personalities and individuals, or is there a way to generalize anything over the years?
What I can say is that each project has its own very particular character. So, for example, Oscar Niemeyer, who I really loved and adored, when we said to him, well, what do you want the staircase to look like? He wrote back and said, well, you design it and I'll tell you if it's okay. So I was like, okay. So Mark Robinson, who is actually not been named and should have been, who was Julie's Burnell's predecessor, designed a staircase and sent it off to him. So that is one way of working. But each project is entirely different. It is true to say that working with younger architects, there is a difference. Simply because younger architects, gentlemen, probably haven't been under that time pressure. I think that's probably true to say. Would that be fair?
That's good. So general nodding. We can't tell if that's a yes or no, but there's nodding
in the room.
But then, you know, established architects haven't either. I mean, what I can say is clearly, there is not one size that fits all, and there's not one rule that fits all. It's really everything is on a case-by-case basis.
Thank you. Other questions in the audience? Anybody? Okay, Laura. And then I'll come back here to one there.
No, here. Do this. And then I'll come back.
Thank you. I want to ask a question regarding your position, Julia, and in general of the architects that have participated towards architecture itself. We are in a time where other architects or the architectural discussion in general is very critical towards architecture being concerned only with aesthetics. With the nature of the pavilion is basically dealing with spatial experience and the aesthetics of it. So I wonder, how do you position yourself in the overall architectural discussion of like what architecture should be or what should we be doing as architects? And how did you see yourselves in doing this project, which is only concerned with aesthetics?
Do you want to answer first?
I can start. I don't think we've. I'm speaking for myself here, but I would say for most of us, I don't think our brief would allow us to only deal with aesthetics. I think we'd be very lucky if we could. That we actually get anything that is aesthetically pleasing. And for us particularly, it's not the first thing. It's probably somewhere in the back of your mind as a trained professional that you need to organize space, material, form, function in a way that is coherent and legible. But we have so many practical problems to solve, even for a summer house. and the brief is still robust enough to ensure that you are trying to meet, you know, a certain size, a certain function, a certain budget, certain technical details that I don't think it was an aesthetic exercise for, at least not for us at all.
Yeah, I mean, I think like nowhere in the brief you have any reference about aesthetics, and I don't think we ever talked about aesthetics throughout the whole process. I think the pavilion is like this architectural experimentation, and when we got the assignment, we looked back at all the pavilions, and we saw that, you know, some of them had been exploring materiality, some of them had been exploring like structures, like, so I think all of them had, like, some of them the content. So I think it is about architectural experimentation, and, you know, that's kind of needed regardless everything else. And then, you know, as a result of that experimentation, then you get aesthetic, usually quite strong aesthetics, but it's never the goal or the scope of the project to make a beautiful thing. Like, it's a result of this architectural experimentation that then...
Okay, one more question back here. Let's do all the way back.
Brett, is it possible if I just may...
Yeah, please.
Comment on that. The function, it's a very simple project. The principle of it is very, very simple. So it has a function. The function is a cafe. That being said, we never conceived the pavilion project because the Serpentine didn't have a cafe until we opened the Zaha. Hadid designed Serpentine Sackler Gallery. The idea of a cafe is to allow people the freedom to spend time in a space without feeling pressure. Nowadays, it's almost impossible for anybody, including myself, to spend time somewhere just sitting, just being. It's a practice that's really unknown to us. If you give people a cake or a cup of coffee or a cup of tea, they kind of feel, okay, I've got my bearings here. So the whole idea about museum visiting is people who come back time and time again to look at a favorite work of art, to get to know it and really, really connect. It's about connection. So the cafe is a very simple device to encourage connection, to encourage connection with the form, to critique it. But this is a critique and a way of engagement by the public. Of course, the architects do that anyway. You all do that. All your friends do it. The world of architecture does it. That's your thing. But we're a publicly funded organization that exists for the public. We want to talk to the specialists, but we exist for the public. There is also an incredible freedom not to have to design lavatories and bathrooms and kitchens. And, you know, we have drains, we have soakaways, but we don't have to think about bloody piping. And that freedom is a chosen one, and it means that the architects can do something else. They can choose to spend their time doing something different, which is to think about design. One of the sections in this very simple brief that we've talked about is that, from memory, the architects were asked to connect the work they do, the design for the pavilion, on their existing work. Now, somebody like Oscar Niemeyer, an architect that I've mentioned already, did it very, very literally. He had a semi-submerged basement and so on, and drawings that he did especially for the pavilion, but had a connection to other drawings he'd made, and. But for some architects, like Smiljan Radic, for example, he had the prototype actually, or a comparable kind of prototype in his studio, it was different. So I come back to this idea of one size not fitting all. And then there's one further thing, which particularly, and no surprise, with Hans Ulrich's involvement with the Serpentine, the marathons, the festival ideas that take place in the pavilion, or close to the pavilion now, less so because it used to be so incredibly cold, and the Park Nights program, which are conceived as part of that process. So I'm not disputing your argument, it's for you to critique what we do or not, but it is, all I can say is from our point of view, it has a different kind of starting point.
I am a supporter of that kind of approach, just to clarify, and I would be quite interested to see if there is a discussion around the making of beauty or a discussion around
the things. I want to say something for Yona, who's not here tonight, within the context of our group. And I think, going back to this idea of aesthetics, I mean, there's a whole world in that project that goes way beyond, I mean, aesthetics may be a part of it, but I think that ambition is probably what we all ascribe to, that there's a resonance between, beyond that work that you see in the park for 4 months. And I think an architect like that, and I think there's many in the history of this pavilion, is thinking back and forth, but at a completely different scale, multiple scales, solving housing, solving urbanism, solving cities. It's not about aesthetics. And I think that's the ambition that we're all in the last 16 years are trying to subscribe to.
Everybody, one last question back here. Let's get to the back of the room.
Hi. Apologies if I missed it in the middle, but did you say how you select the architects?
Very good question. I should have done. It's a curatorial decision. Hans Ulrich and I, we have lists that we continue from one year to the next that we revisit. We visit biennales and exhibitions. We talk to our colleagues in the field. We are specialists for their contributions, and we also research a considerable amount. And obviously the decisions are very, very serious ones that take a huge amount of agonizing. We return to them over and over again, and we think we've made a choice, and then we say no, 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 we go back to the drawing board, and then we think we've done it, and then we go back to the drawing board. So it's really a process. And the reason why the invitations to architects do happen rather late in the day is because our process is a process, and it has to be a process that's kind of concluded. It's like you can't take the cake out of the oven and before it's cooked. And you know, sometimes it's just not cooked. And what I learned over 25 years at the Serpentine is that you have to have very strong nerves, and if it's not ready, it's not ready. And it's as simple as that, because it's easy to make a decision, but the important thing is to make the right decision. And a good decision is always worth revisiting. Hans Ulrich's knowledge is titanic. I mean, he's unbelievably well-informed. And the discussions were fantastic, absolutely fantastic. And this year we had help in terms of our research. We had a huge number of dossiers over and above everything else. And it's a very, very fascinating process. And it's a privilege.
Terrific, Julia. Thank you. And I think we're going to stop it there, everybody, and in acknowledgement of one of the very best decisions you made over the years, which is to launch this adventure and to make sure every year it happened again and again. Everybody, thank you all so much for coming in this evening. Maria, Kunlé, Asif, Frank, Julia, all of you, thank you so much. Also to thank Manager Vergese, who organized this lovely event and got everybody in the same room at the same time.